Good morning, everyone. Thank you so much for joining us today. We are joined here by Rick Fingerman, and we are so excited for this presentation. Apologies. Today, Rick is going to lead us in a presentation on how to manage finances during cancer treatment. And we're going to talk a little bit more throughout the presentation and have time for questions at the end. If any attendees on the call have any questions, we'll be happy to field those. Please just reach out to us during in the chat, and we can field those at the end of the presentation. Without further ado, Rick, I will pass it on over to you. This session is being recorded today and will be posted on in about a week or so to our Blum Digital Resource Center. So be sure to check back for this presentation and in this recording, as well as any other programs that we have available, as well as resources. So Rick, I'll pass it on over to you. Thanks so much for being here. Really appreciate it.
Great. So welcome everyone to another edition of How to Manage Finances During Cancer Treatment. Today we're going to be talking about funding an emergency, basically. So yep, best places to fund emergency. And some of these will apply to, you know, to some people and not to others. So we're going to go through it and just kind of talk about what's the best fit for people. Okay. Oh, who am I? So I'm Rick Fingerman. I am the liaison to the Dana-Farber Pro Bono Financial Coaching Program. I just want to throw out that I'm the guy in the middle with the little trophy. This was several years ago. This was 2011, I guess. But if you are a patient of Dana-Farber or a family member is, you are eligible to participate in this pro bono financial coaching program. If something is keeping you up at night financially, worried about paying for stuff, debt, a little bit of what we're going to be talking about today, you can feel free to reach out to your social worker, resource specialist, or even me personally, and we can get you connected to the program. Okay. Just a quick disclaimer. This presentation is strictly, you know, informational only. It's not meant to be tax advice or financial advice or legal advice. But again, if you have a specific question, you can feel free to reach out to me and I can help you in any way that I can. Just a quick statistic, 75% of patients are actually surviving less than $50,000, which is not a lot of money, especially in the Boston area. So this is a critical area, and we wanted to just get information out to you to provide kind of lifelines in case you're struggling. So what are our goals today? Really three things. We want to learn how to fund an emergency, the best way to do that. If we can plan early, if possible, that's always best because then we're not doing things in a stressful situation. And we want to look at some pros and cons of some various options because some are better than others and some definitely you don't want to look at, but we want to kind of just address them and look through them. So Esmeralda, not her real name, but she was a recent patient, a single mom, had a couple of kids, struggling financially due to, like, you know, her job loss, and the bills kept coming in. So we were able to put a plan together to help her get into a better place. And that's the whole premise of this, is getting you into a better place financially. So what are the next steps? Well, let's take a look. So the first step is creating a list of all available sources. And again, some of these will apply to you, and some won't, and some I'm not recommending, but they're there for, you know, push comes to shove. So let's take a look and see what we have here. So personal savings, this is an easy one. This is money that's in the bank. It's sitting in a checking account, sitting in your savings account. In a perfect world, at my firm, Financial Planning Solutions, when we do a financial plan, a key component of that is having an emergency fund. And this is, you know, usually 3 to 6 months of expenses set aside in the bank that if your transmission falls out of your car or your roof starts leaking, you've got some money to pull from to take care of those things. Well, we don't live in a perfect world, so we don't all have 3 to 6 months or 12 months of savings to cover us for a year. But if you do happen to have that, that would be the first line of defense because there's no cost to doing that. There's no paperwork to fill out. You just simply, you know, just take a withdrawal. The second is home equity lines of credit, also known as HELOCs. So the first hurdle, though, is someone has to own a home or a piece of real estate to be able to obtain a home equity line of credit. The good news there is it's pretty easy to do. If you're working, and you've got equity in your house, meaning you've got a $500,000 house, you owe $250,000 on it, you've got an equity of $250,000 that you could pull some of that from if you had an emergency, and you could just basically write yourself a check as you needed it. And you do have to pay at least interest only over the first 10 years, but it is a pretty cheap way to obtain some cash if that's an option. Family and friends, seen this a few times. Sometimes it goes well, sometimes it doesn't. I think it's Shakespeare said, neither a borrower nor lender be, because it can ruin some friendships or some situations. So I suggest if you're gonna go that route to have things in writing, you wanna have just a little quick agreement that says, I'm borrowing this much money, this is how I'm gonna pay it back. And if I can't pay it back, this is what it looks like, just so people are all on board with that before that happens. Paid family leave. This is a relatively new one. This is great though, because you can get for yourself up to 20 weeks of paid family leave if you're ill. You can also get some extra weeks if you're taking care of a family member. So this is something definitely to look into if you've left your job because of an illness. And there'll be some links at the end of this presentation to some of these things, so you don't have to write all this down. Disability, this is another one. Disability is meant not to cover 100% of one's income, but generally up to 60%. If you're working and you have a disability policy and then you become unemployed because of a disability, you can get some cash. Now, there are two types. There's personal disability policies and there's disability through Social Security. The personal policies through work or on your own are much easier to collect on. The hurdles are not as high as a Social Security application. That's pretty tough. So when I was talking about the ease of getting some of these things, like the savings account, that's easy. Applying for Social Security disability, not so easy. But again, it's an option that if you're eligible, should be looked into. Personal loans, these, on the surface might look good, and you might have seen some of these offers in the mail from like Discover Card or a bank that will just offer you $5,000 or $10,000 or $15,000 with kind of no questions asked. The interest rates tend to be very high on these. They could be up to 30%. So we want to be really careful on signing up for one of these personal loans. Next on our list is life insurance. And there are two types of life insurance. There is term insurance and there's cash value insurance. Term insurance, think of that as like car insurance. You pay your premium. If you have a car accident, you're covered, generally. If you don't pay your premium, they cancel your insurance and you have an accident, you're out of luck. Well, term insurance works similar. As long as you pay your premium, you're covered if you pass away. That death benefit gets paid out as long as the premium has been paid. But cash value insurance allows you to even skip a premium here and there, allows you to borrow that cash from the policy. You can take a loan from your life insurance. Doesn't have to be paid back. Downside is that generally when you take a loan from your life insurance through a cash value type policy, it lowers your death benefit. So it's a caveat, something to look at more carefully before you decide to do that. You can also sell a life insurance policy. Basically, you're turning that policy over to someone else where they become the beneficiary and they'll pay you money up front so you have money to live on. Again, you want to look very closely at these things because there are some fine print that you want to be aware of. Next slide. Here we go. Workplace retirement plan. So if somebody is working, has a 401k, 403b, those plans, if the plan document allows it, usually has a loan provision. You can borrow up to $50,000 or 50% of the value of your plan, no more than that, but you can use it for any reason. And if the plan allows that, that might be a viable option. But again, there's caveats to all these different things, because if you leave your job and you have a loan, generally speaking, you need to pay that loan off within a very short period of time when you stop working. So you have to be careful with that. IRAs, if someone has an IRA, whether it's a regular IRA, traditional IRA, or a Roth IRA, you can actually take money out of those plans too. Roth IRA is a little easier because any money you put in a Roth IRA for any reason, at any age, at any time, you can take that money out. No questions asked, no taxes, no penalties. So for an example, let's say you've put $10,000 in your Roth IRA over the last 5 years, and that $10,000 of contributions has grown to $12,000. You can take out the $12,000, no taxes, no problems, no nothing. The $2,000 is subject to some penalties and taxes, but if you're over 59 and a half and the Roth IRA is at least 5 years old, you can take that money out tax-free, no penalties as well. On the traditional IRA side, for medical reasons, you can take a certain portion out, no questions asked, no penalty if you're under 59 and a half, but you always have to pay taxes on the traditional side because you got a tax deduction when you put that money in. Credit card cash advance, this is not my favorite at all. And I'm sure you've seen some of these things. You get your statement, tells you what your credit balance is and how much you could take for a cash advance. If you look at the rate on that, I've seen rates as high as 29%. Not a good option. But again, in an emergency, with knowing going in, like what that's going to look like, you know, worst case scenario, that might be an option. Do not recommend it, though, generally speaking. I had a patient that mentioned they started a GoFundMe page, and that's just basically an online thing where people have a link and they can give money to you to help you through this process. So there'll be a link to that. It might work for some people. Grants from nonprofits. There are some nonprofits out there that will give you cash grants. There's a couple in Boston that I know of personally. One will, you know, give you up to like 3 months to use towards rent or your mortgage, for an example. Another one is more designed for younger patients that are maybe in college age. I had a patient that I talked to a couple of years back that had a lot of stuff in her house, all kinds of stuff. And she said, you know, I'd like to get rid of this stuff. It's just, you know, driving me nuts. And she said, and I could, you know, use the money. So she actually sold a bunch of stuff. She had the energy to do that. And she raised some money and she cleaned her house up at the same time. So it's kind of a win-win. So that's something to consider if you've got something you want to just get rid of that you're not using. And here we are in step two. So starting early, you know, again, things like applying from a home equity line of credit, we wouldn't want to do that or get a cash, cash out of our life insurance policy the day before we need it or the day we need it. We want to start these things early, especially like a home equity line of credit. The reason we want to start that early is if we're still working, and that seems to be a good option for us, then if we're working, the process is much easier and much more likely to get approved than if you're not working. But if, you know, you are married and your spouse is working and you have a home equity line application out there, they might be able to just use the other spouse's income to get approved. So again, start early. Same thing with like the 401k, not a big process, but Social Security disability, that is something if you feel you need that, that could take 6 months, it could take a year. You will get retroactive payments back from the time of the disability, but it's a long process. So again, you want to really start early, make that list of what needs to be done and what are your best options. And on to step three. So again, yeah, make that list, prioritize what's available to you. If you don't have a 401k, well, then a 401k loan is not going to work. You don't have a life insurance policy that's cash value based, that's not going to work. So we want to look for things that are easy to acquire money. We want to see if there's a cost involved. So if it's 29% interest, that's a high cost. We might not want to go that route. And then look at the ramifications. If you don't pay that home equity line of credit, what's going to happen? Well, it could put a lien on your house. If you know you don't pay the 401k loan off and you leave that job, what's the cost of that? Because that loan does have to be paid off and it might have to come out of the 401k, which just causes more taxes and more problems and things like that. So want to look at the big picture. And here's just a quick resource list. Again, these slides will be available, but here's a link to Social Security so you can learn more about that. A link to learn more about how the 401k loans work, how IRA, you know, hardship withdrawals work. What else do we have here? Let's see. We've got the GoFundMe link, Family Reach and the SAM Fund. Those are the two ones that I'm very familiar with in the Boston area that help families with actual, you know, cash help. There's other things here like, you know, energy assistance, you know, might not put cash in your hand, but if you don't have to pay the oil bill for 4 months, well, that's pretty good. So you want to look at these things as well. There's another slide with some more links. Yep. Just a bunch of different things here. This last one is the paid family leave. It explains how that works and who's covered and what the benefits would be there. I think that might be it. Yep. And then I've got a special offer today only. No, I'm just kidding. Any questions at all, you can call me, no cost to talk to me. Ideally, email is best because then I can send you a link to my online calendar because my calendar does get very full. And then you can just pick a time that works for you. We can have a quick chat. I can answer any questions you might have and then even refer you back to the program if that seems like it's a good fit for you. That's it.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Rick. Really appreciate you being here with us today. Now at this point, we can open up if anybody has any questions that you might be interested in asking of Rick, we can open that up. I don't see anything coming through the chat, but happy to stay on a little bit longer and field those if anything came through during the presentation.
Yep. And if you think of something later on, again, feel free to reach out and I'm happy to either answer the question or get the answer.
Thank you, Rick.
Yep.
Alrighty, doesn't look like anything's coming through, so we can end here for today. Thanks so much, Rick, for being here again and for the wealth of knowledge that you're providing. And thank you to all of our attendees. Once again, this presentation will be posted on the Digital Resource Center in about a week or so. You can look back and see the presentation again, as well as a number of our other programs that we have available and our resources. So thank you so much and have a lovely day, everyone. Bye-bye now.
Thanks.